Even for a moment, Shiva got disturbed. Even the third eye became cool. The fiery third eye. Kalidasa very beautifully describes that Vyaparayamasa Vilochanani Umamukhe Bimbaphalagarvashte Vyaparayamasa Vilochanani. All the three eyes moved around her lips. Then Kama, after the marriage of Shiva and Parvati, he was rejuvenated and he gets back his life. But there, he becomes Ananda. Till then, he was Sanga. Ananda means beauty beyond body. Because unless our attractions transcend the domain of body, our love will not be true and fulfilled. Physical love is not bad, but delimiting at the same level and just restricting to that level of body will only become lust. Starting from Grishma, summer, he concludes at the spring, Vasanta. He could have started with Vasanta itself. There also he brings in novelty.
Namaste.
Namaskar. Namaskar.
Welcome. Namaste, sir. Welcome to the Atharva Forum. As part of the Atharva Forum conversations, we are going to converse on the literary beauty of Kalidasa's work. Kalidasa is indeed a household name in India, whereby we know him as a great poet from the past. He is ironically addressed as the Shakespeare of the East, notwithstanding the fact that Kalidasa lived, composed, and died almost 1,000 years before Shakespeare was even born. Of course, the students who study Sanskrit for their bachelor, master degrees are indeed more knowledgeable about him, but that constitutes a very minuscule section of our contemporary youth. Hence, through interactions like these, we wish to bring back the glories of our past giants like Kalidasa. Towards this, we are very fortunate to have with us none other than a great poet of our times, Shatavadhani Dr. R. Ganesh, who is indeed the sole authority to speak on this topic. As his name suggests, he is a Shatavadhani, he is a Vedagama Shastravit, a polyglot, and he has completed, to my knowledge, at least 1,000 Shatavadhana by the year 2014, and I'm sure the number would have only increased in the past few years. He comes from a science background, having done metallurgy at IISc Bangalore. Welcome, sir. Very thankful to have given your time. May I begin by asking you the first question? It is said about Kalidasa that Pura Kavinam Ganana Prasange Kanishthika Adishthita Kalidasah Adhyapi Tattulya Kavera Bhavat Anamika Sarthavati Babhuva. So my very first question to you is to give us an overview about Kalidasa, his works, and the special status that he holds in Sanskrit literature.
Om Tat Sat. Very good evening and a very, very heartfelt greetings to all Kalidasa Rasikas, and I am highly indebted to our Atharva Forum for giving me this opportunity to share few thoughts on that great master poet. A small correction regarding my introduction. I have performed more than 1,200 Ashtavadhanam and only 6 Shatavadhanam. It's a very difficult feat, only 6 times I could complete. Just pardon me for the small correction. I should be knowing where I stand regarding my ability.
I'm sorry for that mistake. I'm happy to be standing corrected.
Thanks. You introduced Kalidasa with that wonderful verse, Pura Kavinam Ganana Prasange. Yes, of course. Kalidasa is a very great poet of our country, not only of India, but also of the world itself. But at the same time, we should be knowing another great set of poets, Rishi Kavi, where come our two great master sage poets, Bhagavan Vedavyasa and Bhagavan Valmiki. Barring these two, excluding these two, among the other poets of our country, Kalidasa is the greatest. that we have to accept. These two Rishi Kavis, Vyasa and Valmiki, they have become Bhuvanopajivyas, universal resources for all poets, not only India, but even to extended India and other countries also. Among the other poets, Kalidasa comes very close to these two great Rishi Kavis. I always say, after Vyasa and Valmiki, it's only Kalidasa who comes closer to the spirit of Rishitva. He is Mahakavi, Varakavi, Rashtrakavi, and Rishikavi. The real epithet that a person is a Rashtrakavi can go to Kalidasa, because in him we see so much of India. Unlike other poets, where they clearly belong to different parts of India and different sects of our systems of philosophy and agama and other things, Kalidasa belongs to the truest spirit of Vedanta, and he has embraced the whole of India, both its culture and nature. In him, we see every beautiful aspects of India, whether it is flora or fauna, or languages, or cultures, or kingdoms, or food practices, or art, whether it is dance, or music, or painting, or instrumental music, or whatsoever. In every aspect of Indian culture, we see Kalidasa and his remarkable observation. And that's why, for the greatest scholars of our times, 20th century scholar Dr. V. Raghavan from Chennai says, Kalidasa represents the quintessence of the Indian culture and heritage, and whether he is a native who wants to partake of it or an outsider who seeks an authentic messiah of it, to both of them, Kalidasa is most satisfactory and at the same time the most attractive exponent of it. And he also said in some other occasion, all that was written before him went to oblivion, and what was all written after him was mostly modeled on him. In that way, Kalidasa becomes the confluence of all earlier thought and culture and art and poetry, and becomes the fountainhead of the later productions. In that way, it became the yearning of all the poets to become another Kalidasa. Various Kalidasas are there. They have Abhinava Kalidasa, Navanava Kalidasa, Akbari Kalidasa, and so many. In that sense, Adhyapi Tatkulya Kavera Bhava Anamika Sarsvati Bhuva. That is really true. We see prose, poetry, and song are the three aspects of language. A language can be expressed in three forms: prose, gadyam, and verse, padyam, and geetam, song. In Kalidasa, we see all these three. Prose, of course, is usually seen in his plays, and not many people have cared to look into the nuances of his wonderful prose. And verse, his master craftsman there, and his epics and lyrics, they are all present. And in the plays also, we have very many beautiful verses. And in his plays, he has written plenty of aryas. They are highly musical in nature. And that's why he has used maximum number of arya meters in his three plays. And that takes care of the song. That's why Rig, Padyam, Yajus, Gadyam, and Sama, the song. Rig, Yajus, Sama, all the three Vedic forms that have been successfully adopted by Kalidasa. Starting from this form, whether it is lyric, Khandakavya, where the theme is independently expounded, and Mahakavya, where Prakhyata Itivritta, means well-known theme from the Itihasas and Purana, have been taken. He has taken care of both. And also in Drishyakavya, Nataka, he has taken his themes from both Veda and Itihasa. Apart from that, he has taken from the history of India. Annals of Indian history has taken. Malipagmitam, the testimony for that. In that sense, he has completely utilized all that. And we have also the tradition of Bratkata as the poet, as a poet Kaviraja from Karnataka. He wrote Raghava Pandaviyam. He speaks of this. And also another poet from Bengal, Govardhana, contemporary of Jayadeva. He says, like the Triveni Sangama, Ganga, Yamuna, and Saraswati, Vyasa, Valmiki, and Gunatya, they represent the three streams of Indian culture and poetry. Vyasa and Valmiki take care of Dharma and Moksha to a great extent, while Artha and Kama are taken care of by Gunatya. Kalidasa has not ignored the stream of Gunatya also. ఇది మేఘదూత అంటే ఉదయన కథ కోవిద గ్రామ గుర్తాహ అరౌండ్ ది ఉదయన స్టోరీస్ ది హోల్ ఆఫ్ బృహత్ కథ ట్రెడిషన్ బృహత్ కథ ట్రెడిషన్ రివాల్వ్స్ దట్ సెన్స్ కాళిదాస్ హస్ క్రియేటెడ్ ఆల్ హిస్ కంపోజిషన్స్ ఆల్ సెవెన్ వర్క్స్ విచ్ ఆర్ నోన్ టు అస్ టుడ్ హావ్ కంపోజ్ మెనీ మోర్ వి సీ ది అమాల్గమేషన్ ఆఫ్ ఆల్ దట్ ఈస్ సీన్ హియర్ ఇన్ హిమ్ వి సీ వేద ఇన్ హిమ్ వి సీ వేదాంగ స్మృతి ఇతిహాస న్యాయశాస్త్ర అండ్ అదర్ సిస్టమ్స్ ఆఫ్ ఫిలాసఫీ అండ్ ధర్మశాస్త్ర అండ్ ఆగమ అండ్ ఉపవేద సో ఆల్ ది 14 విద్యాస్థాన యాజ్ కాళిదాస మెన్షన్స్ ఇన్ రఘువంశ ఫిఫ్త్ క్యాంటో ఆర్ ఇన్ 18 విద్యాస్థాన యాజ్ ప్రెజెంటెడ్ బై ద గ్రేట్ సేజ్ స్కాలర్ మధుసూదన్ సరస్వతి కాశీ వారణాసి ఇన్ హిస్ ప్రస్థానత్రయ హి మెన్షన్స్ 18 విద్యాస్థాన ఆల్ ఆర్ కవర్డ్ బ్యూటిఫుల్లీ బై కాళిదాస That's how both in form and content, he is a distorted monarch of Sanskrit and Indian culture. If you have any further question regarding this, you are welcome, most welcome.
That is really a kind of a broad overview. And as you have said, as Kalidasa was proficient in multiple aspects, it is indeed our good fortune that we have you talking about him. Your glory is that your glory is also widespread in multi-dimensional aspects. So that's why it's indeed, we find it fortunate that we have you talking about him.
I remember one verse, Kavayat Kalidasa Adhyavahincha Kavinamakaha Parvate Paramanavucha Pada Tumpratishtam Even Kalidasa is a poet and me too a poet of my own humble order. But it should never be a comparable thing because even an atom is matter and mountain is also matter. So what will matter if they are equated? Certainly it matters too much. That's how we have to think. In my school days, because of my ignorance, I had no great respect for Kalidasa. Sheer ignorance. Every time when I speak about Kalidasa, I do open my talks with my own confession, which I wrote later. Yat kaishore kritam anuchitam nirvishankam hatasham satkavyanam laghu nirathanam chalpata melpa buddhya స్మారం స్మారం తవ శివకృతి రన్వహం తన్ను కుర్యాం ప్రాయశ్చిత్తం కవి కులగురో లజ్జయా తజ్జలాక్ష దిస్ ఇస్ మందాక్రాంత మీటర్ పర్హాప్స్ దిస్ మీటర్ ఇట్సెల్ఫ్ ఈస్ ఇన్నోవేషన్ ఆఫ్ కాళిదాస ఇన్ మై అడాలసెన్స్ బికాస్ ఆఫ్ మై ఇగ్నరెన్స్ ఐ నెవర్ టుక్ యూ సీరియస్లీ పర్హాప్స్ ఐ థాట్ దేర్ ఆర్ అదర్ పోయిట్స్ హు ఆర్ బెటర్ దాన్ యూ ఇట్స్ ఆల్ మై ఇగ్నరెన్స్ అండ్ నౌ ఐఎమ్ పర్ఫార్మింగ్ అన్ యాక్ట్ ఆఫ్ ప్రాయశ్చిత్త ఇట్స్ డెమాన్స్ట్రేటింగ్ మై సిన్స్ by propagating your thought and by eulogizing your works and by going to your work again and again and visiting them frequently and getting enlightened. That's how I've got a newer vision. Lajjaya tajjalaksha, my shyness after having ridiculed you with my ignorance has to be cleansed with my tears of repentance. That's what I'm doing. In that sense, in Kalidasa, we see the beauty at its peak, and even the aspects of Indian culture. For example, you take foundations of Indian culture are seen in our samskaras. For example, every person has to undergo few samskaras. In Gautama Dharma Sutra, the number of samskaras go up to 41. In the general parlance, they have 16 samskaras, shodash samskara. Though great seer poets like Vyasa and Valmiki, they don't take much of their work in delineating the features of these samskaras. But in Kalidasa, we see most of these samskaras. In Raghuvamsa, we see lot of references to these samskaras, starting from Namakarana. To every king of Raghu dynasty, he gives etymology. That is Raghu or Rama or Aja or whosoever. Or even Lava and Kusha, he keeps starting from etymology, that is Namakarana. And before that, we had Jatakarma. And before that, we had Kumsavana. And then, starting with Upanayana, he mentions even after Upanayana, Samavartan Samskara, Godana. Godana is tonsuring the locks. And then, going for Grihastashrama. And he eulogizes Grihastashrama in the lines of Manu. Dvitiyam sarvashram rakshana kshamam ashram. That's how he mentioned. And then sannyasa, before that vanaprastha. In the opening canto of Raghuvamsa, The very first canto in the beginning itself he says, Shaishave Bhyasta Vidyana, Yavani Vashayeshana, Vardhake Munipatina, Yogyanam Tedam Tanutijana. Like that, he gives the four-folded ashrama and also the real spirit of Varna. He never discriminates. He never makes disparity in lower Varna or higher Varna. And at the same time, he gives respect for work. In Shakuntala, in the sixth act, we have a Praveshaka, a small scene of Nivara Prasanga as Vikar. There he says, my profession being a fisherman is as sacred as the profession of a Brahmin. Pashumanana karma dharano kyanukampa mrudurepishvatyaha. A Brahmin may be undergoing a sacrifice there. Pashumadha may be required. In spite of this, he is Karunavan. He is very compassionate. So is my profession. In spite of me being a fisherman, and not for any cruelty, like that he says. That is how Kalidasa looks at every aspect of society. And also, in the Shravana Kumara Prasanga, he has taken care of that. And also regarding the disparity between men and women, he never makes such distinctions. He says, when Parvati was denouncing all the seers who are men, they respected her. Bhavabhuti says, Guna Puja Sthanam Gurushu Nachalingam Nachavayaha. He clearly gives the inspiration to Bhavabhuti and says, when the person is virtuous, we never bother about birth, gender, caste, creed, race, and other things. Guna Puja Sthanam, Bhavabhuti said. Before that, Kalidasa himself says, Gunas are virtues, are the most respectable thing. But also, when Parvati was pronouncing other seers, they got inspiration from her. They corrected, they mended themselves. In that sense, Kalidasa gives a lot of inputs to understand Indian culture. A person who wants to understand and feel Indian culture, the best and the briefest thing it can be done, briefest work which he can depend upon is the writings of Kalidasa. In Kalidasa's works, it is very small in volume. All the seven works put together, they will not cross 700 pages. In Kalidasa, we see a brief but authentic exposition of Indian culture. And his mind prism has given the seven colors in the form of seven works. Ruksamhara, though his initial work, earlier work, it may not be having great poetry when compared to a work like Meghduta or Shakuntala, or even Kumara Sambhava. But that theme of seasons has never been attempted by others. Though in Bhagavan Valmiki, they have beautiful description of the four seasons, Hemanta in Aranyakanda, then Vasanta, Varsha, and Sharatkala in the Kishkindha Kanda. All other seasons, for example, Grishma and even Shishira, they are all explained beautifully in the work of Kalidasa, that is in Ruksamhara. Starting from the name, he has so much of Vakrata, as Kuntaka mentions. Vakrata is needed even in naming. Instead of just saying Dushyanta Shakuntala, he says Abhijnana Shakuntala. Instead of saying that Shiva Parvati Pradayam, he says Kumara Sambhava. Like that, everywhere he brings in beauty and novelty and the oblique expression that is seen in the initial work itself. And also, in Ruksamhara, the location is most probably his native place, which may be around Vindhya region. Perhaps most probably it is Ujjaini. And he keeps space as constant, and variable will be time. So all the six seasons will be variable. And starting from Grishma, summer, he concludes with the spring, Vasanta. He could have started with Vasanta itself. There also he brings in novelty. We have a proverb in Kannada, Yella Mugadu Mele Bella Irbeku. In conclusion, he should have sweet. He should not end with an unpleasant ring. And that's so he starts with a very serious season, very hot season like Grishma, and then he moves to Varsha, Sharat, Hemanta, Shishra, and finally it is Vasanta. And there also he utilizes a lot of imagery. and these imageries are not efforted, they are very natural. And then the hero is Kashchid, someone. He is addressing everything to his beloved and is describing the whole beauty of seasons to his consort. In the same way in Meghaduta, where time has become constant and space is changing, starting from Ramagiri of central India to Alakavati, northern India, up to that, the space is changing, the landscape is changing, at the same time, rainy season, that remains constant. Like that, in his two works, Khandakavya, he beautifully interchanges the concepts like constant and variable. First, in Ritsumhara, it is the space that is constant and time varies. Desha is constant and Kala is variable. In Meghaduta, it is Kala that is constant, because Desha has become variable. Like that, he has so much of novelty. Even in Meghaduta, the cloud itself is Nayaka, and all the rivers are Nayaka, whether it is Virabhutkantika or Vipralabdha or Swadhinapatika or whatsoever, all these Nayakas, they appear. What are the Nayakas which are discussed by Bharata and Natyashastra? They come to action in Kalidasa's Meghaduta. In Meghaduta, we see nature being treated in the form of human being. This way of juxtaposing the animate in inanimate, or imposing, superimposing life in lifeless things, so-called lifeless things, because we Vedantins, we believe that Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma, everything is full of vibrant, full of Chaitanya. But Kalidasa knew this. And so he superimposes so much of human element in cloud and other details. In that sense, what Kuntaka says, as Vimachara Vakrata has taken Vishwarupa, universal feature, in Meghaduta itself. We see a lot of Vakrupti and Swabhavakti both in Kalidasa, as Dandi mentions, Vidavangvayam. The whole of literature can be demarcated into two areas. One is realism and other is oblique expression. Realism, in the sense, it is the deeper and subtler observation, not the bald and dull and contemptuous realism that is propagated in the materialistic West. It is the realism of spiritualism here in India. And that's why Swabhavokti is a very unique alankara. That's Abhyalankriti, as it is mentioned by Gandhi. And in Kalidasa, we have so many other features which have been respected and identified by our Alankarika. The greatness of a poet lies in withstanding all sorts of evaluations, all sorts of criticism, the positive or negative sense. For example, our earlier Alankarika, they identified Alankara as the central thing in the Kavya, in any Kavya. That's how Alankriti becomes important, whether it is Bhamaha or whether it is Udbhata or even Udrata. They emphasized more of Alankara. And all of them concluded that Upama is the Atyalankriti. Upama is the most important Alankara. As Appai Dikshita says in his Chitra Vimamsa, Upamaika Shailushi, Upama is that one dancing girl who takes all forms, and in those forms we see all other Alankaras, all other figures of speech. And Kalidasa wields Upama at his best, and that's why he is called Upama Kalidasa. So all the people, Alankarika critics and aestheticians, poeticians who came and propagated Alankara, they agreed upon this conclusion that Upama is the best and Kalidasa is best in that realm. Then came the Ritivadins or Margavadins, who are the champions of style, Ritiratma Kavyasya, as said by Vamana, or Marga, as propounded by Dandi, and Vaidarbha Marga is the best, and even Vamana agrees upon that, so also Dandi, and even other poets, poeticians too, agreed upon this. And all of them, they said, Kalidasa is the best among the Vaidarbhi exponents, as in the words of Rajshekara, Ya Vaidarbhagiram Vasaha Kalidasa Dhanantaram, while speaking about Vijjika, he is saying, he is referring to Kalidasa. After Kalidasa, Vijjika is the best. Means first comes Kalidasa, even in diction and style. And so, as Alankaravadins agreed upon one thing, so also Ritivadins propounding some other thing, there also Kalidasa came out with flying colors. And then came the Dhvanivadins, Anandavardhana says, much about Bani and his champion of Bani. Suggestion is the soul of poetry, Kavyasyatma Dhanihi. And he says, in this world, so many poets are there, but only few poets countable on fingers, Vitra Panchashava Mahakavayai. Only Kalidasa, they had Vitra Panchashava. Only people like Kalidasa, who are two or three or five, but the most, they may be treated as great poets forever. In this sense, Kalidasa also emerges with flying colors when he is evaluated from the perspective of Dhvani. And then Kuntaka in his Vakrokti Jivita says, Vakrokti is the lifeline of Kavya. Vaidagya Bhangi Bhaniti. So Vakrokti is the lifeline of Kavya. And for that, he takes a lot of examples, maximum examples from Kalidasa. My mentor, great scholar, Dr. K. Krishnamurti, he wrote a paper itself on this theme, Kalidasa as expounded by Kuntaka. And then we have Rasa. Starting from Bharata, we have so many politicians propounding the importance of Rasa. Everyone had agreement with Rasa. And there, Raseshwara Kalidasa. So Kalidasa is the champion of Rasa. Anandavardhana says, among the Rasas, Shringara is the best. Shringara eva Madhuraha Param Prahladano Rasa. And then Kalidasa is the most successful poet who has delineated Shringara without slipping into the depths of vulgarity. And in Kalidasa, Shringara takes its fulfillment. And then Auchityavadins, like Kshemendra, they said, Pathet Samastan Kila Kalidasa Krita Prabandhan. One who has to, wants to become poet, is desirous of becoming poet, should always read all the works of Kalidasa. In that sense, everyone who came with one or the other approach for good poetry, for the best poetry, they ended up in declaring that Kalidasa is best in that. Why? Even the moderners, starting with the Westerners, they look into it, whether he is Wilson or Keith or Ryder or whosoever, starting from 19th century. And even in this era, all scholars have one agreement that Kalidasa is the best among their theories, among the scholar, among other poets who fit to their theory, who is capable of conversant with, who is capable of responding to their theories, who is capable of representing their theories in their work, in his one own work, it is Kalidasa. In that sense, Kalidasa has stood the test of time. This is very, very difficult to achieve. Now, we shall move on to other features of Kalidasa. Any question?
As you rightly said, Kalidasa is steeped in the Indian culture because some of the metaphors or similes or upama that he uses, like Shruteri Vartham Smritiranva Gacchat and things like that. So, all his works expounds the tenets of the Veda and the Upanishads, as you have rightly portrayed. And when you were comparing the beauty or the power of criticism, I was reminded of this Madhuravani's line, Kasturika Chandana Kumkumadhye Udvartitangi Yotiva Divyet. So only when the poetry is discussed scholars, it shines forth like a damsel with Kasturi and Chandana. Anyway, so moving forward, coming back to the topic, according to you, what are the varying aspects when he is handling a play and a poetry? Or do you find them both of them same? Or what are the differences?
Fine. Very good question. In Kalidasa, we see both Itivritta and Varnana. Itivritta means theme. Varnana means narration, description. In Itivritta, we have the story, we have the plot, we have the characters. And in Varnana, we have conversation, description, imagery, and whatnot. Both these should go together. In Vyasa and Valmiki, we have lot of Itivritta. We have profound Itivritta. Here and there, we do have Varnana. But Varnana is not elaborate there. When compared to the Varnana of later poets, like Bharavi, Magha, Sriharsha, and others, the Varnana of Vyasa and Valmiki, they are very brief, but effective. But these poets, later poets, who developed ornate diction at all, they have a lot of variety in Varnana. But they don't have any original theme. They don't have original story. They don't have original character. They don't have original characterization. Plots, subplots, and so many things. They are all not unthinkable in those poets. But in Kalidasa, we see him as a Madhyamani. In Sanskrit, we have Madhyamani Nyaya. It connects to both, something like a pendant in a beautiful necklace. Here we have in Vyasa and Valmiki, lot of characters, profound characters, and story, themes, and subplots. In other poets, we have so many descriptions, so much of imagery, so much of filigree work. In Kalidasa, we see both. He is coming to the fringe. An example I can take, much of Kumara Sambhava is Kalidasa's imagination. And much of Raghuvamsa is Kalidasa's imagination. Though Raghuvamsa is an epic poem containing more than 1,600 verses, only 500 verses belong to Ramakatha. And to that extent, he is indebted to Valmiki. While other more than 1,000 verses, they are devoted to other kings, where Kalidasa's imagination has worked a lot. While delineating the story of Nandini and Dilipa, or Kautsa and Raghu, and even Indumati Swayamvara, or Kusha reconstructing Ayodhya, which was fallen and eroded, and then the fall of Agnivarna, in all these, and also the Rajaniti of Patiti, in so many such features, Kalidasa has extended his imagination and has developed original theme. And also in a Khandakavya like Meghaduta, the theme is original. And even in the plays, for example, Shakuntala, though he takes the main story from the Adiparvan of Mahabharata, the incidents like Durvasa Shapa, Dhivara Prasanga, Maricha Prasanga, they are completely based on his own imagination. And later, Padma Purana takes these themes. Some people have interpolated that into Padma Purana. And in that sense, even the Puranic writers, they are indebted to Kalidasa. Like that, the theme and story Itimritta has been independently developed by Kalidasa. And even the story of Malavika Agnimitra, much of it goes to Kalidasa's credit. Why? Even in Vikramorshiya, though the theme is as old as the Shatavata Brahmana and even Rigveda, in Rig Samhita Dashama Mandala, we have Purvashi Purvarava conversation. And in Shatavata Brahmana, we have the story of Purvashi and Purvarava. But entirely different story has been spun by Kalidasa. While we have something like a hint for play within play, we have that, though it is not deliberately presented as Garbhanka, like it was first presented by Sriharsha in his Priyadarshika, Kalidasa gives a hint towards that in Vikramorshiya. In that sense, he has so much originality. And in description, as we mentioned, a beautiful verse, Puraskrita Vratmani Parthivena Pratyudgata Parthiva Dharma Patnya Tadanta Resa Viraraja Dhenuhu Dinakshapa Madhyagate Vasandhya. A profound thing. There itself, Smriteri Vartam, Shruteri Vartam, Smritiran Vagachati. How Dilipa followed the cow, sacred cow Nandini, like the Smritis, the later texts on Dharma Shastra, following the Aporsheya, that is Shruti. Kalidasa uses such imagery, a very, very telling imagery. It reveals the whole of our tradition, how our tradition followed. It is the Aporsheya Veda, and that is followed by the Paurusheya Shastra, Kavyas, and other things. That's so we should have Apaurusheyatva in connection with universal experience as being expounded by masters like Gaudapada, Shankar Bhagavatpada, and then Sureshwaracharya and others. That is the universal experience, Sachidananda Ghana, Nirvishesha Sarvatrika, Pratyaksha Sarvatrika Anubhava, that is based on Avastatraya Mimamsa. That becomes the core of Shruti, like the Mahavakya, Aham Brahmasmi, Tattvamasi, Prajnana Brahma, such things. And then the timely Shruti Smritis, Kale Kale Navacharaha, Navavani, Mukhe Mukhe, like that we say about different Smritis. कृते तु मानवः प्रोक्ताः त्रेतायां शङ्खलिखितौ द्वापरे याज्ञवल्क्यश्च खलु पाराशरः स्मृतः डिपेंडिंग अपॉन डिफरेंट ईरा डिफरेंट युग इन कृतयुग इट वॉज मन इन त्रेतायुग शङ्खलिखित अंड इन द्वापर इट इज याज्ञवल्क्य अंड इन कलि इट इज पराशर लाइक दैट वी से सो द स्मृति लिटरेचर दे आर बेस्ड ऑन स्पेशियो टेम्पोरल फ्रेम्स वेल श्रुति entirely depends upon universal experience and it reveals that Kalidasa brings home, drives home such a key aspect in his Kavya, through his Kavya. And also the telling imagery, taking from nature, our culture, our Shastra, our fine arts. I shall give a few examples earlier mentioned about Dilipa followed by Nandini and Nandini being followed by Dilipa's wife Sudakshina. Dilipa is clad in white dress, while the queen is clad in dark blue or dark color dress. While Nandini Denu is a cow of reddish brown in color. In that sense, the day, evening or dusk, and then night, they are followed together, they are brought together. It means, though we have these three parts, these three divisions in time, they are made by us. Though they are seen in nature, for a person who is outside the realm of earth, sun and other, in space, he cannot distinguish between day and night, dusk or dawn. So, these things are temporal in nature. Time is absolute. That is a wonderful question. At the same time, in the relative realm, these differences do exist. That's so, the Sapekshatavada, the Vivartavada has been suggested there, and also a beautiful picture of the king leading the cow, and cow is being followed by the queen. And even the suggestion of the dresses, how simple the king and queen are, and how bright the cow is. And the color of cow is already indicated, though the verse appears in the second canto, in the first canto, at the end itself, Lalato Dayama Bhugnam Pallava Snigdha Patala Vibhrati Shvetaro Mankam Sandhye Vashishinam Navam. Barring a white patch on her forehead, the rest of the body was as reddish brown as a tender leaf. Pallava, as we call in Sanskrit. So it was that such a cow is called in our Shastras as Kapila. Kapila belonging to that color, depending upon that color, Kapila Varna. Like that, he gives the suggestion, and the best among the cows is Kapila. Kapila, Shabala, Dhavala, like that, there are several breeds of cows. Of them, Kapila is the best, the Gir cows, it is said so. In that way, Kalidasa gives details of so many things connected with our agriculture, animal husbandry, and other things. And also, the imageries are so telling and so picturesque. In Kumarakambhava, second sarga, second canto, when all the devas go to Brahma and plead for a savior from the tyranny of Tarakasura, Indra wants Brahaspati to speak on behalf of all these deities. And then he says, you just talk to our god, Brahma, Prajapati. He not even utters anything. He just looks at him through all his thousand eyes. ततो मंदानिलो भूत कमलाकर शोभिना गुरु नेत्र सहस्रेण नोदयामास वासवः. We have to imagine a beautiful lotus pond. Thousands of lotuses are bloomed. If a gentle breeze passes through them, then all the lotuses will move to a corner. Gently they move. So the thousand-eyed Indra, casting all his looks towards Brahaspati, his mentor, he directs him to plead for them with Chaturmukha Brahma. That's so, all the eyes are moving towards one corner where Brahaspati is standing. That is a beautiful nature picture. Like that, there are so many such. Unless Kalidasa has seen such a beautiful scene in nature, he could not have composed. Unlike many other poets, have not seen anything. Kalidasa has seen everything. In the fourth canto of Raghuvamsa, we get a wonderful picture of whole of India in a pradakshinakar. You see, here again, Kalidasa's knowledge of geography is seen. and love for country is seen, and also his devotion towards sampradaya is seen. Devotion towards our practices are seen. It is clockwise movement. Starting from Ayodhya, he moves upwards to Himalaya. He moves towards east, the most sacred direction, to east, and then goes towards south, and then moves up to moves towards northern direction, and then goes to west, and then moves again up to northern India, that is to the mountains of Himalaya, and then comes back to Ayodhya. Like that, it is a complete pradakshina patha, where every nook and corner of India is being described. I'm so happy that I belong to Karnataka. Even Kalidasa had passed through Karnataka, and he describes Kerala, Karnataka, and other places. He mentions in Raghuvamsa 8th canto Gokarna. Even today, we respect that place as the place where Shiva's Apalinga is seen, and that is Mahabaleshwara Kshetra, Gokarna Kshetra. He mentions that. And he never forgets to mention that Kerala, known for tender coconuts. Soldiers of Raghu, they enjoyed the tender coconuts, and even beetle leaves and beetle nut. And for that matter, Kalidasa is the first poet to mention the pan, beetle and beetle nut. Before that, no poet has mentioned. And in the period of Guptas, we do get references to this pan in their inscriptions also. Kalidasa has that. And later works like Tambula Manjari with 800 verses have been developed there. But Kalidasa is the fountainhead for that. Even for a small practice like that, and we know the Tambula has become such an indispensable thing in all our Shubhakaryas. That's why we have so many cultural details. And he mentions Tamraparani, Murala, and other rivers of South India, Kaveri, and others. Every region is mentioned. Here he traces the terrestrial path. And in other canto, in the sixth canto, he, while describing the kings who have come for the Swayamvara of Indumati, once again takes an opportunity to describe India. Whether it may be a Pandya king, whether it may be a Ujjaini king, or whether it may be a Shurasena king, while describing the kings, he never forgets to mention the area which is being ruled by them and how beautiful those areas are. And also, in the Meghaduta, he takes an aerial path. From Ramagiri to Alaka, whole of India has been described vividly. He never even forgets to mention small rivers like Gambhira or Vetravati or Gandhavati and other such rivers. And then in Raghuvamsa 13th canto, he takes another opportunity to describe India from even higher plane. It was earlier in the 4th canto on the terrestrial and on the aerial. Now in the celestial plane, he describes India in the course of moving of Rama and Sita and Pushpak Vimana from Lanka to Ayodhya. Beautifully, the landscape is described along with the incidences which are quoted in Valmiki Ramayana, which are represented there. It's something like a flashback technique our poet displays. The great seer and very great connoisseur of works of Kalidasa, Paramapujya Rangapraya Swamiji of Karnataka, he mentions, Kalidasa describes this in the form of Bhur Bhuvah Suvah. Bhur, terrestrial, Bhuvah, aerial, and then Suvah, or Swaha, the celestial plane. In that way, he again connects to the Vedic spirit, this Mahavyahrutis, as we call it. That is so, while Kalidasa is representing anything sensual, he is also representing the spiritual thing. And that's why it's a misnomer which has been spread long and which has been widely spread, that Kalidasa is Shringarakam. Yes, but Kalidasa's Shringara is very sublime, very unique, and very great, very profound in nature. I shall discuss about that later while speaking about Kumara Sambhava. The real etymology of Shringara is Shringam Richati iti Shringara, one of the commentaries of Bhojaraja's Shringara Prakasha it gives. Another work of Bhojaraja, Saraswati Kanta Bharana Deri, it is said so. Shringer Iyate iti Shringara, summit effect, which is a sublimating feeling, that is Shringara. Kalidasa caters to that. In his Kumara Sambhava, Parvati wants to marry Shiva. First she goes with an intent that Shiva would accept her by looking at her beauty. Because in the opening canto itself, Parvati from top to toe has been described very beautifully, vividly by Kalidasa. And this became the template for all other poets to describe their heroines. But Kalidasa is the first person to do so. We don't find such description of the heroines of Vyasa and Valmiki in the Mahabharata and Ramayana. In Kumarasambhava, they have such a vivid description of Parvati in first canto. And so she is naturally confident of her beauty. But when she goes to Shiva, Shiva never cared for that. In the end of first canto, Kalidasa says, Parvati was consoled only by the moon, the crescent moon which was on the in the matted locks of Shiva. Tachirash Chandra Padaihi Avachita Balipushpa Vedi Sammarga Daksha, like that in that verse. He says, somehow she was consoled by moon, but by Chandra, but not by Chandrasekhara. That is the suggestion. And Parvati, then she wanted to attract Shiva and wants to prepare so many things. She used to bring water, she used to fetch the five sticks, samits and others. And in the third canto, she comes like a moving creeper, Sancharini, Pallavini, Ladeva. Bees were getting attracted by her lotus-like face and they were coming to her face, and she was driving away those bees by wielding a lotus in her hand. Leela Tamala means a beautiful lotus which was in her hand. It means bees come to flowers, but these bees were driven by flowers and they were coming to her face. It means her face was much more beautiful than the lotus. That is this Dhani suggestion. Such a beautiful Parvati. When she came, even Manmatha, the god of love, had come to conquer Shiva and wanted to destabilize his inner composure, wanted to shoot his five tender arrows. Was taken aback by looking at Shiva. How was she? Mano navadvara nishiddha vrittim hridaye vyavasthapya samadivashyam yamaksharam kshetravido vidustam atmanam atmanyavalokayantam. He has withdrawn himself. He was in pranidhana. All the pancha prana were sealed. And atmanam atmanyavalokayantam. He was contemplating upon his own self. Aham brahmasmi. Soham, in that way he was contemplating them. That was such a great, highest stage in tapasya, yoga, samadhi. Manmatha was taken aback, and without knowing, unknowingly, his arrows and bow, they slipped from his hand. Then by looking at Parvati, he gained back his confidence. And how was the girdle belt which was used by Parvati? It was a beautiful lotus creeper. He thought it is something like the string of the bow. If his string of the his bow string breaks, he can use that. In that sense, he got assurance from Parvati's very presence. When Parvati went to Shiva and wanted to submit a japamala which was prepared by herself, by picking up the seeds of lotuses which were grown in Mandakini, in Devaganga, when she was about to offer, even for a moment, Shiva got disturbed. Even the third eye became cool, the fiery third eye. Kalidasa very beautifully describes that Vyapara Yama Savilochanani Umamukhe Bimbaphalagarvashpe Vyapara Yama Savilochanani. All the three eyes moved around her lips. But then Manmatha thought, usually is an opportunity wanted to shoot. But immediately Shiva gained back his composure and saw what's happening. And Krodham Prabho Samhara Samhareti, even before the deities could scream, beg for pardon, Basma Avashesham Madanam Chakara. So Manmatha was seen as a heap of ashes. But Parvati, then she got offended. All my beauty, all my charm was of no use. This is what we want to realize. The physical beauty has nothing to do with in our path of realization. all the physical charm becomes useless. This Annamaya Kosha, unless it is going to realize Anandamaya, there is no use of that. As the words of Yajnavalkya Smriti, Ayam hi paramo dharmaha, yad yogena atma darshanam. Yes, so atma darshana is not going to happen, there is no use of this body. Shariram adhyam khalu dharma sadhanam. It is adhyam dharma sadhanam. The body should become tool for his realization. Parvati was insulted without making any deliberate effort by Shiva. Tatha samaksham dahata manobhavam. In front of her, the Lord of love, Lord of desire was burnt. Means her desire itself was burnt. Then Ninindarupam Dadayena Parvati. Parvati wholeheartedly chided and wholeheartedly discredited and even discarded, disowned her beauty. Ninindarupam. She blamed her beauty because Priyesha Saubhagya Phalahi Charuta. The real purpose of beauty is to attract, to make our beloved happy. If our beauty are not appeasing the person whom we love, there is no purpose of this beauty. He wanted to love, she loved and she wanted to marry Shiva. When Shiva is not bothered about her beauty, there is no use of that. Then Yesha Sakartum Avanchya Rupatam, wanted to make her beauty flawless and fruitful, so she discarded beauty. This is beauty beyond body. Her beauty of her long locks were given to serpents. Serpents are often compared to locks, Nagaveni, Pannagaveni, like that. She gave away her beauty of locks, flight to serpents, and gave away her beauty of smile to flowers. Many times we say, smile is compared to flowers. Pushpa smita, poo nage, as we call in Kannada. Mugul nage, mugul in Kannada means flower. And also her beauty of eyes were given to deer. Many times we say Harinakshi, Mrigakshi, Yenakshi, like that. And also her slender body's beauty was given to creepers, Latangi, Tanvi, like that we say. All that means the things which are compared for beauty got their beauty from Parvati. That is the suggestion. And what was left with her? Only love for Shiva. And tapakiledam tadavakti sadhanam. I am going for penance. I am going to conquer Shiva in that positive way. Yeshasakartum avandhya rupatam, like that in the fifth canto opening itself, poet says, this though transcending the body and beauty beyond body is the hallmark of Kalidasa in Shringara. And we say that throughout Shakuntala also. In Shakuntala also the same way. See, Shakuntala is nothing but the byproduct of Kumarakambhava. In Kumarakambhava, Shiva penanced for Parvati and Parvati penanced for Shiva. Though it is not clearly said, Swayam Vidhata Tapasakvalanam Kenapikame Tapaschachara. Though he is the bestower of the fruits of all penances for all people, for what reason he penanced, we don't know. Means he is doing Nirlepa Karma. Kripana Phalahetavaha, as said by Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, mean are the people, chief are the people who do penances or who do work for results. Shiva is not bothered about results. But Parvati, she wanted to get Shiva as her consort and entered into penance. Very strict penance. That's why she couldn't even, she was not even consuming food, not even withered leaves. And that's why she was called Aparna. In the words of Shankara Bhagavatpada, Palabhyam, Nijatapa Palabhyam. Apavikshita says, Paraspara Tapasampat Palaita Parasparo. Parvati became the fruit of Shiva's penance, and Shiva became in turn the fruit of Parvati's penance. Like that, when Parvati was penancing, Shiva came to herself and ultimately submits Adya Pravritya Vanatangi Tavasmitasaha Vitastapo Bhiriti Vadini Chandra Maulo Anhayasa Nemacham Klamutsa Sabja Klesha Phalayani Punar Navatam Vidhate. From one onwards, I am your Dasa, I am your bonded labor, like that. He pleads for love. Then you see the dignity of Indian culture. She never goes with Shiva then and there. She says, she even says that through her Sakhi, Atha Vishwatmane, Gauri Sabdi Desha Sakhi Vita dapame bubhritam natha pramani kriyamiti. She tells to her beloved Sakhi, friend, you please tell him that to marry me, he has to contact my father. Means, it would have become Gandharva Vivaha, but Kalidasa wants to graduate that to the level of Brahma Vivaha. That's so, he adheres to our tradition so well, so beautifully. He should become Dharma Shrangara instead of Kama Shrangara. Because according to our Dharma Shastra, Gandharva Vivaha is Kama Shrangara. It's not wrong. Our Dharma Shastrakaras have permitted 8 types of marriages where one among them is Gandharva. Among the 4 better forms of marriage, it is Gandharva also. But the best is Brahma. And that's so Shiva, Rishin Jyotir Mayan, Sapta, Sasmar, Smarashasanaha. Then he remembered the 7 great seas, Saptarshis. Then Arundhati too comes. In the form of Arundhati, he respects womanhood. Arya Pyarundhati, Ivandya, sage Arya Arundhati, she can negotiate the marriage very well because Purandrinam Pragalbhata, in these matters of marriage and negotiations, it is only the women, they fare better. And the 7 sages along with Arundhati, they go to father of Parvati, Mavan, and then marriage is fixed. That's so. Then Kama, after the marriage of Shiva and Parvati, he was rejuvenated and he gets back his life. But there, he becomes Ananga. Till then, he was Sangha. Ananga means beauty beyond body. Because unless our attractions transcend the domain of body, our love will not be true and fulfilled. Physical love is not bad, but delimiting at the same level and just restricting to that level of body will only become lust. And so it has to be graduated to the level of prema, advaita dampatya. That is what Kalidasa sees, and that's what Kalidasa forges in the marriage of Shiva and Parvati. That's how in Kalidasa's Shringara we see Shanta, where the highest rasa. So Kalidasa is Shringara Kavi should never be mistaken for wrong reasons. Kalidasa is Shringara Kavi for the right reason. We have to say Shringara is also called as Shuchi Navarkosha. He is also called as Ujjvala. Shuchi means pure and Ujjvala means brilliant. Kalidasa Shringara is Dharmartha Kama Moksha Shringara. As Maitreyi was Mokshapatni of Yajnavalkya, so was that in the concept of Kalidasa. Any other question?
Dhanyavad Mahodaya. So you have given us a very comprehensive literary beauty about Kalidasa. And as you were mentioning about that, Kalidasa gave realistic, minute details and not just fictitiously writing it. Even though, despite being a kavi, he has poetic license, but then still he has weaved that poetic license into the reality as he has experienced. Even though we have Apare Kavya Samsare Kavireva Prajapati, despite that, he has kind of maintained maintained his bondage to the reality, and he has composed.
What you said about adhering to reality and adhering to nature without any fantastic fancy, which is unrealistic. In Kalidasa, we see true adherence to nature, true adherence to culture in all its beauty and reality. In Kalidasa, truth and beauty are not divorced. They are one and the same. For example, in Raghuvamsa, in the 16th canto, he describes mutilated Ayodhya, eroded Ayodhya. How fallen was Ayodhya after the departure of Rama? After Rama had his Mahaprasthana, none ruled Ayodhya. Rama was so impartial, all the 4 brothers had 3 children. And so the 8 siblings of the 4 brothers, Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, and Shatrughna, got 8 different provinces, and none got Ayodhya. Because Rama thought it is not fair to give Ayodhya to any one person. But somehow, due to lack of management others, we don't know for reasons beyond our comprehension, Ayodhya got eroded. On one night, the Ayodhya Devi, the goddess of Ayodhya, she came to Kusha, eldest son of Rama, and eldest among the 8 brothers. And in him, in his bedroom, he saw that the goddess of Ayodhya in a pathetic situation. He says, without even idea, he couldn't identify her, but before talking to her, he says, be comfortable, because we kings of Raghuvamsha, we never look at any other woman with wrong sight. So be confident, be assured of that. Then she says, I am ruled by all your forefathers, and now mine is the pathetic situation. There she gives contrasting pictures. How was it earlier and how is it now? Earlier, beautiful Abhisarikas in evening, they used to move on the steps of banks of Sarayu River. Now, it is only wild animals like tiger, cheetah and others which kill other animals and move there on the steps, and their footprints which are soaked in blood are seen there. Earlier, the Abhisarikas who were decked with lac, whose feet used to be anointed with lac, alka, that used to be printed there, and now it's happening. Earlier, peacocks used to dance around. Now, because of the forest fire, all the feathers of peacocks were burnt and they are running away somewhere. Like that, every time he gives contrasting pictures, and this way he describes a city. How was it and how is it? And how an eroded city, how a ruined city has to be rebuilt, that suggestion is also there. Ganga Devi, a great poetess of Vijayanagar times, who was a daughter-in-law of Bukkaraya and consort of Kampana in her Madhura Vijaya, she says that how is the pathetic situation of South India, whether it is Srirangam or Tiruchirappalli or other places, how they have been devastated by the plundering, ruthless onslaught of the Islamic warriors. She gives a picture, very pathetic picture, and that is inspired by Kalidasa, Ayodhya Vardhana. Like that, he is so honest and apt in descriptions. And even while describing nature, he never goes out of that. For example, if we are describing spring, he mentions only the trees which flower in that season. If he is describing rainy season, for that matter in Meghaduta, in rainy season, Kutaja means forest jasmine, that flowers, and also Kadamba, that flowers, then another Ketaki, that flowers, and he gives how the Ketaki gradually eat flowers, and also Kadamba, how it gradually flowers. And he says, Nipam Drishtva Harita Kapisham Kesarair Ardharudam, like that in Meghaduta at one place. And as the cloud moves, when it comes to Vidisha, by that time, Praudhapushpaihi Kadambaihi, he says. He not even forgets the mushrooms which rise only during the rainy season. Uchilindra Bhavandhyam, like that he mentions in the very beginning of Meghaduta. It means he is not even ignorant of these features, and he will not even ignore such features. His pan-Indian and universal outlook, it has placed every such beauty. And then while describing the Alakavati, he gives, it is an ethereal place, it is heavenly abode, there all seasons come together. And that has been beautifully suggested in one verse, Kaste Leela Kamala Malake Balakuddha Kundanuvidham Chudapashe Navapuravakam, like that. In that particular verse, he gives all the flowers which flower, all the details of the trees and flowers which are seen in respective seasons. He starts with Sharakkala, Haste Leela Kamalam. In autumn, we have lotuses, Haste Leela Kamalamalake Balakundanuvidham, the Kunda, tender jasmines, they are the products of Hemanta. And then Neetam Lodhra Kasava Rajasa Pandutam Anarashri Lodhra in the Shishira. And then we have in the Simantecha Padupagamarjam Yatra Neepam Tarunyaha. In the locks, we have the Neepa. Neepa means Kadamba flower. That is rainy season. That season which he is describing, he comes back to that. That then, the details of nature are beautifully given. And in Kalidasa, we can reconstruct all that. For example, another instance, he said, Sampat Chinte Katipaya Dinas Thayamsa Dasharna. In Dasharna, you can see the swans which stay for a while. They are migratory birds. Even today, they are seen like that. They are not permanent birds. Like that, he gives such details even in Shakuntala. As per the character, as per the situation, he gives apt simile. Kanva is a Kulapati. He's a great teacher who gives food, clothing, shelter, and other necessities to his students and then nurtures them and teaches them all Shastra. And such a person naturally is a born teacher. And he says, Sachishya Parigrihita Vidyeva Ashoshaniya Samrita. When he comes to know that Shakuntala is married to Dushyanta by the right of Gandhara Vivaha, he says, as my knowledge has been given to a deserving student, you are married Dushyanta, and so I don't have any botheration, any worry. I'm not feeling bad. And also, even without my notice, you are married. No problem. Roma dhre, dhuma kulita api drishtihi, drishtiya avatir ajnaveva pitta. Though the yajamana, the person who is giving oblations in fire, who is offering oblations in fire, in spite of the smoke choking his eyesight, Ahuti has rightly fallen in the sacred fire. In the Yajneshwara itself, the Ahuti is given. So in my absence, you have married, but you have married a worthy person. Here again, the imagery is Arshaya, is very Vedic in nature. Because every day, every evening, every morning, he offers oblations into the sacred fire. And that's why it comes to his picture. And also Dushyanta, when moving away from Shakuntala, he thinks, though my body is moving away from her, my heart is moving towards her. When a chariot is running, moving, though the chariot is moving forward, the flag will be flapping behind. It is a very keen observation that only a person who owns a chariot and has seen chariot and how he moves and how the flag is fluttering in the air, that person can only know Kalidasa gives such things. At the same time, he gives hilarious imagery also to Vidushaka. Because according to his mindset, according to his culture, he gives, how come you are enjoying the beauties of the royal harem? Now you have turned your eyes to the girls of Hermitage, he says, who has been tasting Khandakarjura. Khandakarjura means very sweet Kharjura. Now you are going towards Tintinipala tavern. How come it is possible? Earlier we are enjoying sweet dates. Now we are turning towards tamarind. Is it good? Again, Vidushaka is known for his, what you should say, he is always fond of eating. Who is always bothered about eating. A very good eater he is. And he gives imagery in the form of that. Eating itself, eating itself. That is, though every aspect of Kalidasa is governed by Auchitya. Any other question?
Yes, Mahoday. So it is like... my next question is of more of an academic curiosity. Like Ramayana and Mahabharata have been the source of inspiration of all our poets, dramatists, and to all others who are engaged in Sanskrit literature. So just for the sake of comparison, can you please give us a few examples how Kalidasa distinguishes himself compared to others while describing this object or an episode from these two Mahakavyas? Of course, through this question, I am not intending to belittle other poets, but it is to get an understanding of the literary beauty of Kalidasa.
You want to compare other poets with Kalidasa, or comparing the episodes of Ramayana and Mahabharata with Kalidasa?
Any one common episode from Ramayana and Mahabharata where Kalidasa yes. has excelled compared to the other poets?
Well, Kalidasa naturally has taken from Vyasad Valmiki, Param Kavinam Adharam, like that it is said in the Ramayana itself. But he adds his own flavor. For example, in Valmiki Ramayana, Ahalya, when she was cursed by Gautama after the episode of Indra, she was unseen. She was not seen by anybody and she was repenting in an unseen corner. In that way, Valmiki depicts Ahalya. But Kalidasa makes the whole thing as a metaphor. He says that Ahalya had become turned to a stone. Ahalya was Shila Bhuta. In that way, all her isolation and all her frustration and all her purgation is completely metamorphosized, completely metaphored, and that metaphor is being presented as a stone. And this became so attractive, and all the later poets, with no exception perhaps, they all treat Ahalya had become stone. And even today, we see in our dances and even in music, Ahalya being shown as a stone, and Rama turns her into a lady. And Bhoja, another king poet, a royal poet of 10th, 11th century, in his Champu Ramayana, he says the same thing. And even our Tyagaraja, a great music composer of South India, he says, Dharini Shilaye Tapamudalchi, when Ahalya had become, was turned to Shila, rock, like that. The later poets, later composers, irrespective of their language or region, they follow Kalidasa. And that's why Ganga Devi says, Dasatam Kalidasasya Kavyah Kena Vibhrati Idaniyamapi Tasya Arthan Upajeevantyami Yatha. Everyone, every later poet has become Dasa, a slave of Kalidasa. And that's why they are using Artha. Artha means idea. Artha also means wealth. They are paid by Kalidasa, and so all the poets are working for Kalidasa as slaves. Not to undermine later poets, but they have. And other poets, many times while dealing with the themes of Ramayana, they have not improvised Kalidasa. For example, Bhavabhuti, a very great poet, though he is supreme in Uttar Ramacharita, in Mahavira Charita, he is not up to mark. The story of Ramayana, as given by Kalidasa, especially in the 12th canto of the Bhumsha, is unparalleled. In hardly 80 or 90 verses, he comprises 5 cantos: Ayodhya, Aranya, Kishkindha, Sundara, and Yuddhakanda. 5 cantos he comprises. And even later poets like Rajshekara, author of Balaramayana, or Jayadeva, author of Prasanna Raghava, another play, or Mallinatha, author of an epic Raghuveera Charita. For that matter, even Abhinanda, a poet from Bengal, 8th, 9th century, author of Ramacharita. No other poet has bettered Kalidasa. Why? Even Kumaradasa, it is said that when Raghuvamsha was in existence, how come Kumaradasa could write Janaki Erna in a very jovial way? Rajshekara makes fun of that. Janaki Haranam Kartum Raghuvamshe Sthite Sati, in a verse, he makes an appreciative comment about Kumaradasa. And such a good poet, gifted poet, Kumaradasa, in his Janaki Haranam, never betters the theme as compared to Kalidasa. So, in Kalidasa, we see all that beauty. Why? Even in one line, he makes a remarkable change, remarkable value addition. When Sita, who was staying in Valmiki's hermitage, got the news that Rama is performing this Ashwamedha Yaga. We all know, in a sacrifice, only a person who is married, and when his wife is next to him, sitting next to him, then only he can perform the sacrifice. Apatnika, who is devoid of wife, who has divorced wife, or who is devoid of wife, cannot perform any sacrifice. Patyur Yajna Sayoge, that is the very meaning according to grammar also. That is the very etymology of Patni. That being the case, how come Rama could indulge in sacrifices? That's what she may get the doubt. But to clear that, immediately she is Kalidasa says, she got the news that having kept Surana Sita, a new golden image of Sita, next to him, Rama is performing all these sacrifices, then she got consoled. So much of solace. Because no honest wife would pardon that. Even she would bear the pangs of separation of the beloved husband, but not her place being taken by some other woman. Because she may even bear the pains of separation or viraha, but not another sapatni. That's so Kalidasa justifies Rama. Kalidasa saves the dignity of Rama and also the glory of Sita. That way of value addition, no other poet has done in later period. That is how in Kalidasa we see truth and beauty, dignity and delicateness, always going together.
Dhanyavad Mahoday. You have earlier also mentioned about this greatness of Kalidasa, and throughout we have been talking about Kalidasa. But I am a little curious about one more poet, who is Pandit Raja Jagannatha. Of course, he has lived some 1,000 years after Kalidasa. But in him, we see that Amulat Ratnasanoham Malaya Valagitat Achakulat Payodhihi. In the last line, of course, he says that
Vacham Acharyatah Posti dhanyo madanyaha.
Whereas in Kalidasa we see Mandak Kaviyasha Prarthir,
yes.
Gamishyam Yapam. So these two contrasting personalities, and how do you kind of compare their literary beauties and these two personalities? Over to you.
Unfortunately, in our tradition, well, for that matter in the world itself, many times right persons will get a right recognition. And sometimes the wrong person will get very much recognition. And Jagannatha is one such person. People who are fans of Jagannatha may pardon me, but I should say he is no match to Kalidasa. If someone says that in so many respects Jagannatha is better than Kalidasa, we can't agree. It's a blatant error. That's what I honestly feel. At the most, we may say that Jagannatha had a very musical and tender diction. But that diction is not his. Even before him, there were many poets who wrote. For example, long before Jagannatha, Mukha Kavi is there. In Mukha Kavi's Mukha Panchashati, we get the diction which is much, much better than Jagannatha, and the Vakrokti is far better than Jagannatha. And Jayadeva, who existed even before 500 years before Jagannatha, is far more superb poet than Jagannatha in terms of music. There is no parallel to Jayadeva. Like that, there are so many people who are very musical diction. Why? In Bhavbhuti, in Sriharsha, in Harshavardhana, in many poets, writing mellifluous verse is not a big thing in Sanskrit. So many poets are writing. But to write Arthavad Bharati, so dense with meaning, pregnant with meaning, it's very, very difficult. One verse, one example I shall give. Titakshanam pakshmasuta ditadhara payotsaru payodharu sedanipata churnita valishu tasya skrita prapedire chirena nabhim pratamoda bindava. This is the verse that describes Parvati in penance, in scratching summer, in deep summer. When she was pronouncing, she was sitting in a yogic posture and she was pronouncing, when first rain droplets, they fell on her. The description is very picturesque. I'm not going to those details. A beautiful article is written by my friend Shashi Kiran, which is available in the Preksha Internet Journal, where people can look into. In an English article has been written. Malinatha describes how the beauty of Parvati, her physical beauty, has been suggested wonderfully in this verse. And Appai Dikshita, in his Chitra Mimamsa, describes the same verse, analyzes the same verse, and shows how her yogic posture and the philosophy behind that and the Shanta Rasa behind that has been depicted, suggested in this verse. In the same verse, Shringara and Shanta is a very, very difficult feat, and only Kalidasa could do. There are so many such instances, many, many such instances. A profound verse, one verse which depicts the whole life of Kalidasa's, whole philosophy of Kalidasa's life, and even the philosophy of Indian culture itself. Jugo patmanamatrasto bheje dharmamanatura agradhunuradade sortana satta sukamanvabhu. Dilipa, he protected his body though he was not scared of death. We should protect our body for sharira madhyam khalu dharma sadhana. For what? For moksha. So jugopa atmana matrastha, having no fear for death, he protected his body. Vete dharma manapuraha, he did all good things. was a very, very dharmic king. He did yajna, dana, tapas, everything well, but not because of fear of Narata, fear of hell. Because Semitic religions, they always advocate the fear of death, the fear of hell. But our tradition is not. Our tradition is not working based on the fear of punishment for one's own reason. That's why Kalidasa too says, and even in the Bhagavad Gita it is said, I am not desirous of anything, yet I am performing my duty intact. That's what Nana Vaktavyam Aptavyam Name Kinchana Vidyate Nate Kinchana Vidyate Kalidasa says that. That's how the Nishkarmya Siddhi and Nishkama Karma has to be accomplished. And Kalidasa says that Bheje Dharma Manatura Atura means agitated, scared. Anaturaha, without any agitation, without any fear, dharma bheje. He followed dharma. He acted as per dharma. And then agradhuradade, so on. He was not avaricious. He was not greedy. And yet, he amassed wealth only to distribute for others. Sahasra guna mutrishtum adhate hiratam ravi. Sun draws water only to give back in the form of distilled rain water, crystal pure water. Though he draws saline water from oceans, he wants to give away crystal pure water, distilled water, soft water to one and all. That's how Agradhur Adadeya Sortha Asatta Sukhamanvabhu. He enjoyed the life, but without any attachment. Asatta Sukhamanvabhu. This is what we need, as Krishna did. He was lord of Ashtamishis and 16,000 princes who were conquered by Jarasana, who were conquered by Narakasura, and yet he was Brahmachari. In the episode of Parikshit being rejuvenated by Krishna, he said, if I am a Brahmachari, let this dead child once again come back to life. It happened. Means Krishna was Brahmachari in the real sense. In Kannada, there is a proverb, Badasi Brahmachari. Even with indulgence in sensual pleasures, he was a Brahmachari. That's how Asakta Sukhamanvabhu, such a verse Jagannatha cannot even dream of. But so, Kalidasa, embodiment of humility, and at the same time, embodiment of knowledge. Jagannatha wrote only panegyric verses, wrote only eulogizing things. His Panchalahari, mostly modeled after Shankara's Shivananda Lahari and Saundarya Lahari. His best Lahari is Ganga Lahari. Ganga Lahari, starting from meter and other things, it's completely based on a half of Saundarya Lahari. And his Karuna Lahari is very pathetic in front of Appai Dikshita's Varadarajastava. It is no match. It is very, very dull. And Sudha Lahari is completely modeled after Mayura's Surya Shatakam. Mayura existed before 1000 years of Jagannatha. And in that sense, all his five Laharis, they're imitations. Are not imitations, they are very, very poor, like Karuna Lahari. And then his Jagadabharana and Pranabharana, the same work has been attributed, has been given as token of the respect and appreciation to different. It is something like you write the same paper and send it to 3-4 journals and simultaneously get it published in the name of different research papers, changing here and there some cosmetic changes. He dedicated that to Jagat Simha of Jaipur, and then Shahjahan of Delhi and Agra, and Pranamarayana Kamaru. Even it is also said that it has been dedicated to Jahangir also. So one work being dedicated to four people. Like that, what his poetry is, it is very superficial. And his anyoptis, Prastavika Vilasa. In front of Ballata, he is very dull. Ballata is the most original poet in anyoptis. Why? Take a contemporary of Jagannatha like Neelakanta Dikshita. He is no match to Neelakanta Dikshita. So, it is wrong to compare even Kalidasa and Jagannatha, let alone saying Jagannatha is better. But the qualification of Jagannatha is, he can write very lucid and neat verses. To acquire proficiency in versification, I say Jagannatha is one among the must reads. I have a big list of must-read Sanskrit poets for different reasons. Though he is not best-read, he is a first-read poet for such and such reasons. And even his Ratha Gangadhara is not a great work when compared to Dhanya Loka or Vakrokta Jeevita. Well, whatever they be, Kalidasa is a seer-like poet and sage-like poet, Rishikalpa Kavi. Well, Jagannatha is a poet whose life is also corrupt. We all know the episodes of Lavangi. Dilli Vallabha Pani Pallabha Kale Neetam Naveenam. He boasts that his youth was happily and blissfully engaged in the harems of Mughal kings. He cannot become an ideal for true Indians, true Vedantins.
On that note, I mean, having explored the beauty of Kalidasa, I, on my personal behalf and on behalf of Atharva Forum, express our heartfelt gratitude to you for your time and for your brilliant exposition. And I'm sure we will have more opportunities to interact with you on various other topics. Dhanyavad Mahoday. Thank you.
Thank you.